Welcome to the fourth session of the 2015 webinar series, Geriatric Emergency Preparedness and Response Collaborative, known as GEPR, sponsored by the National Association of Geriatric Education Centers and hosted by Stanford GEC. My name is Jack Downey, SGEC's media coordinator. The overall theme of this series is strengthening preparedness and resilience capabilities in vulnerable adult populations, coordinated by Dr. Melen McBride. The subject of this fourth webinar is the importance of gap analysis in improving geriatric disaster preparedness and resilience. The two presenters for today's webinar are Paula Scalingi and Dr. Melen McBride. Dr. Scalingi has 35 years of experience in government, the private sector, and academe. She serves as executive director of the Bay Area Center for Regional Disaster Resilience, president of the Scalingi Group, LLC, and adjunct associate professor of Georgetown University's Medical Center. Since 2001, she has worked nationwide with stakeholders to undertake and sustain activities to improve all hazards resilience with focus on community health. Currently, she is also assisting the U.S. Department of Homeland Security's Office of Health Affairs to develop a Community Health Resilience, CHR, toolset of guidance and resources, and the California Department of Public Health to undertake a CHR exercise series. Dr. McBride has over four decades of interprofessional career in gerontology, geriatrics, ethnogeriatrics, and disaster preparedness. She has numerous publications, print and online, in these areas, and recently contributed two chapters to the book Disaster Preparedness for Seniors, a Comprehensive Guide for Healthcare Professionals with Charles Kefalu, MD. She joined the Stanford Geriatric Education Center in 1991 after completion of the Robert Wood Johnson Clinical Scholars Program at UCSF School of Nursing. She received her doctoral degree from the University of Michigan Ann Arbor School of Nursing. Upon completion of this session, participants will be able to describe briefly the importance of gap analysis in disaster preparedness and resilience work and low-cost methods and tools that can be used for this purpose. Identify and describe examples of outcomes of gap analyses and where these have been utilized to improve individual and community preparedness and resilience. Give an example of an application of gap analysis specific to a population such as the diverse community of older adults. There will be a question and answer session at the close of the two presentations. Each presentation will last 20 minutes. As you listen, please ask whatever questions come to mind by using the chat feature at top right. Access the chat window with a click on the voice bubble icon. Please remember to complete the webinar survey at the close of today's webinar. You'll find a link to that survey in the chat window. And now, here is Dr. Paula Scalingi.
Hello, everybody, and welcome. It is my pleasure to be here to provide you this webinar presentation. This is the second one. We did another webinar. It was last March. This is really a follow-on to this. To give you a good appreciation of community health resilience and how it particularly can help assure disaster preparedness for older adults, but looking at that gap analysis, when we spoke to you last March, and I hope some of you can reference that webinar we gave at that time, we did lay out a process of how you could engage stakeholders involved in all aspects of geriatric preparedness and resilience, bring them together, develop a gap analysis, and an action plan. This webinar is going to focus on basically how to develop that gap analysis, and particularly lessons learned from other gap analyses. You could use this as a checklist to pretty much do your own, and to other tools and resources you can use for this purpose. In the last few years, and some of you I know have been working actively with your emergency managers and public health officials in your states, region, and communities to help better prepare older adults for significant all-hazards disasters. This is good, definitely a positive step, But one of the big challenges that we see across the country is that so oftentimes older adults' needs are put in the context of more broadly at-risk populations. And they get lost in the noise. And yet we know, looking at major disasters, that it is older adults that bear the brunt of health issues during the event and then after the event. So we need to focus much more clearly, specifically, on looking at those geriatric preparedness and resilience needs. In doing that, there's no way that we can't look at it within the broader context of community health resilience. Community health resilience, some of you know, is becoming sort of a focus area on its own. It doesn't have any set definition, but it's really the ability of a community to understand the consequences it faces from adverse events, recognize the gaps, develop and strengthen capabilities, and improve preparedness and resilience. And by that token, both geriatric and community health resilience means you need to enhance the resilience of older adults, their caregivers, the hospitals and other health providers and support facilities that serve them. It's really essentially that whole logistic supply chain of services that support the geriatric population. This means bringing together those different disparate groups and, again, identifying the gaps, the capabilities, and what you need to do to rectify the shortfalls. I mentioned to you the webinar that we held last March, and that this time around we're going to focus on that gap analysis piece. If it's accomplished well, and that doesn't mean super frills, and one of the most important points I can leave with you, there, if you go on the web and you see different community resilience toolkits or approaches, and they talk about a gap analysis, so oftentimes it's some extremely intensive with using consultants and takes months. It doesn't have to be that way. It can be done no frills with volunteers. There have been different gap analyses done throughout the country looking at community resilience. And I'll speak about typical lessons learned from those in a moment. I really haven't heard of any. There must be some out there. And if there are, please let me know, that have focused specifically on resilience of older adults, geriatric resilience. So if you know of one, please email me. I'll give you my contact information. You'll have that at the end. The gap analyses are commonly conducted, if you're going to do it no frills or with actually consultants, you need to use certain tools. You can use interviews, focus groups of experts and practitioners. You can hold community meetings, surveys. Particularly useful are seminars and workshops and facilitated tabletop exercises that have specific scenarios where you can have organizations, diverse organizations, being able to talk about needs and capabilities that they haven't really shared before. What gap analyses typically identify as major shortfalls, I'm going to give you a general overview of these. And it's really interesting. If you're looking at cross-sector coordination and decision-making challenges, so oftentimes organizations that serve older adults just don't coordinate and communicate. They're silos. That's very typical. If you're looking at response and initial recovery needs, well, you can point to some thoughtful jurisdictions that have actually identified where their assisted living and nursing homes are, and maybe looking at needs of older adults, again, in the context of at-risk groups. But looking at what we're facing now in terms of new unknown hazards, and particularly climate change extreme events, we're talking about superstorm Sandy type events, extreme heat, extreme cold, ice storms, severe drought that is impacting certain parts of the region that can lead to firestorms in some of these areas. These are hazards that older adults, we really don't have the capabilities to deal with. Looking at infrastructure interdependencies, this is really a huge gap of looking at how prolonged outages of electric power, natural gas, public and private transportation, communication services, where you can have seniors that are homebound or in elder care facilities, and basically they're without key services. It could be even for weeks, in some cases for months, and being able to deal with that. Not having the ability to reach out in an emergency situation to elders who might be at home and their caregivers and get that two-way communication of what's their situation. That's another huge issue. And then how do you monitor those who are sheltering in place? And here in the Bay Area, the city of San Francisco is doing a great deal of work looking at how they can shelter their citizens in place in a major earthquake, which in my view is extremely problematical. Somehow you're going to have to monitor how those older adults are being able to survive, and we need to know where they are and how to do this. Evacuations, oftentimes now we're going to find that disasters will happen with no notice, and how are we going to get seniors out? How do we know where they are? Many of them will not be willing to leave their homes. A lot of times it's the family pet that's the issue. And again, we need to look at ways to deal with that. And one of my biggest concerns is we don't have a good handle on events that could cause toxic air emissions. That can be factories, it can be hazmat sites, oil refineries, that you can have a toxic cloud that is going to require individuals to shelter in place. They're going to have to know the procedures. They're going to have the communication of when to do this and when it's all clear. Again, looking at older adults, how do you convey that information and be able to do this? Looking at hospital surge, looking at decontamination for hazmat events. Again, I just got through attending as an observer an exercise that we had, a series of exercises in the Bay Area for one of our major counties at one of our major hospitals, where they were testing out their decontamination for an air emission event. And you can see there in the picture I have, we took that with my cell phone. Those are the stalls, the shower stalls, that they will put the individuals that have been contaminated in to hose them down. It's very primitive. They have to have procedures where they're going to have to do triage and separate out older adults. And with certain needs, it will be incredibly traumatic for many reasons. We have to get a better handle on procedures for older adults for a situation like that. And then looking at points of distribution for essential water, food, how do we get older adults to those points of distribution to get them those essential supplies after a major emergency? Looking at temporary, longer-term housing needs, again, we need to look at those in terms of where and how we're going to handle older adults that will have different needs in terms of physical disabilities, mental disabilities. And then what sort of mechanisms can we use for sharing information to get a better handle on these needs? I mentioned about hospital surge capacity. There's good work being done looking at pediatric hospital surge across the country. but then looking at geriatric health services, again, how do these need to be upgraded? Training of volunteers, of neighborhood CERT teams on how to deal with the needs of older adults in emergencies. That's extremely important. And then incorporating this into regional planning. Now, one of the gaps that so many places have is certification of emergency personnel to go into facilities and areas that have cordoned off after an emergency. Well, certainly you want to have a certification process for assisted living facilities, nursing homes, so that you can get that essential personnel to staff those homes back to where they need to go. Looking again at the post-disaster phase, the process of relocation, reentry of displaced older adults, simply tracking them if they indeed had to evacuate and then come back, absolutely essential. And then procedures for infection control and hazmat and debris and refuse removal will be extremely important for shelters and elder care facilities to contain potential health issues. Looking at legal and regulatory issues, that's important. There are going to be HIPAA requirements. They're going to have to be addressed and in terms of medical records for older adults. And then simply training social service and human care organizations and other service groups on geriatric preparedness and resilience needs, including particularly those behavioral issues that may crop up post-disasters with older adults. So this gives you an idea of a lot of the different needs that you will find in when you're doing your gap analysis. And one of the most important is the training for local government, other stakeholders. I mentioned here on scam prevention, but simply having guidance for volunteers and then outreach and education to elected officials on geriatric resilience needs. Elected officials, we find, are usually the last to really sort of get this stuff. Having scenario-based workshops and tabletop exercises are really good ways to do that for them. And that is one of your best tools for the gap analysis. Now, what I will leave you with the Department of Homeland Security's Office of Health Affairs, there's a great group of people there, and they have taken the initiative to develop a tool set, I was privileged to be part of the team to do that. We have a 100-person stakeholder group contributing this. There is the link to it. This is in beta version. What this is meant to be is a one-stop shop. And so we actually need your contributions. If you have some good capabilities to add to this, if you access it, there's a guide in there that tells you about community health resilience, and we have we look across the spectrum of prevention, preparedness, response, recovery, and mitigation needs, looking at all different aspects of community health resilience, and one of those areas of need is geriatric health resilience, and we need your help to flesh that out. So please do access that. I hope those of you out here listening today, if you haven't already thought to do so, will move forward to launch your own community geriatric resilience initiative. That's what we're calling it, as part of a broader community health initiative in your region. And again, there's just three really broad steps. The outreach to the core stakeholders to build interest. You can do this through holding a geriatric resilience roundtable of just the core, maybe 20 or so key players in your community to get at the ball rolling. Then you can hold a workshop to bring in the much bigger group, then develop the gap analysis, your action plan of improvement activities, and really important here, that action plan needs to be infused, I love that word, and incorporated into the ongoing community resilience and broader preparedness improvements being made in your community or region. It can't be done in isolation. It's all part of that community resilience process. We are currently in the Bay Area moving in this direction. We held just this last, about a couple of months ago, our roundtable on geriatric resilience. And we had about 20 different key folks there. And then we're now looking forward to moving toward the next step. So thank you very much and look forward to your questions.
Thank you, Paula. Just to let you know that these resources are available through a link to the download in the chat window at right, just below the survey link. And now Dr. Melen McBride will give her half of the presentation.
Thank you, Jack. And thank you very much to the participants today. Probably the term that some of you might not be familiar with is ethnogeriatrics. That's the specialty that the Stanford Geriatric Education Center focuses its all its resources in developing educational programs. And just a short, simple definition of this term is a subspecialty on the cultural context of health and aging in older adults from ethnic and racial minority communities. For this webinar, the Presidential Policy Directive 8 and the subsequent response of FEMA to this directive underscores the need to continue to develop, enhance, or refine emergency preparedness and resilience plans at all levels across the nation. It was clear the post-disaster reports from 9/11 to the subsequent disasters that followed led to the president's conclusion that we are still unprepared for major disasters. The depth of preparedness at the regional, state, and local areas are uneven. More attention must be directed to understanding the variability in demography, culture, social, health, and lifestyle characteristics among populations to achieve a national preparedness and resilience that can withstand the catastrophic impact of all hazards events. The concept of whole community for disaster preparedness and resilience was adopted to promote the principle that there are roles and responsibilities for everyone: government, private entities, institutions, organizations, communities, and individuals. Collaboration and cooperation are essential processes to the strength and resilience of the country and the people. So my task today is to talk about gap analysis, how gap analysis can help in disaster preparedness and resilience for older adults from ethnic minority communities. And on the slide is a link to a gap analysis tool that was put together by the California Primary Care Association to be used by clinics and community health centers. And I'm very happy to see the slide. I think you have a copy of this. It was sent to you attached to a reminder email about the webinar. And if you had had a chance to look at it, you know that it is a checklist. It has 37 items and grouped under five categories, and which are the emergency operation plan, response capability, community integration, finance administration, and diminished infrastructure. It is a very comprehensive tool and can be adapted to various settings. All the items have relevance to the older adults from ethnic minority communities, but in this talk today, I'll just highlight some of the items. For the category of emergency operation plan, it is imperative to have guidelines to communicate with hard-to-reach and vulnerable populations, and the agency should be ready to use them for conducting exercises, outreach work, and in actual disaster events. And it's very important that when you do have an interpreter as part of the responder team, that they really are available to you, because right now that's a very limited supply, And as far as I know, most of the institutions and agencies are using a telephone type of interpreter service. And so you have to think, what will you do if you do not have telephone lines and electricity? For the response category, staff training on skills to manage interactions with older adults and their caregivers are essential, and contracting with vendors who serve the ethnic minority communities are part of the preparedness and resilience plan. They would be very important source of information when you start looking at stockpiling supplies and what are the supplies that the minority communities use often and purchase from businesses. We'll continue to focus on community integration and finance administration. Those are the two additional categories. And involving adults from ethnic minority communities in pre-planning and periodic assessment of the emergency plan and reaching out to these communities to encourage volunteers can help not only with staffing needs, but also this is an investment in long-term partnership. Translated educational materials, public service announcements need to reflect the written and spoken languages and the literacy level among the ethnic elders groups in the service area of a specific agency or institution. Taking the time to project an estimate of financial impact on businesses and its effect on vulnerable and at-risk groups in specific areas and isolated communities can help with pre-disaster planning and mobilizing the community to strengthen their capabilities and raise the level of resilience for that population. A gap analysis, as Paula had mentioned, has many different approaches. And here I will be talking about a gap analysis that used research reports and publications. In 2010, a study supported the perception that people from ethnic and minority communities and those who are language challenged do not receive information about disaster and preparedness. They fail to access resources and have poorer outcomes in a disaster situation. This still continues to be a gap. And so when you go back to your institutions, take time to find out what is the institution's preparedness plan and find out where the different ethnic, the elders are mentioned and all those who have these kinds of issues of language issues, as well as certain kinds of cultural issues. I had put this up for you to kind of look at this and reflect on the different kinds of hazards that all of us would face if there was a disaster. And think about what the elders' needs might be for their preparedness and resilience. And then add to that the possibility that the ethnic elders on those who have functional literacy issues are complicated by the fact that they may have certain health conditions that may render them slightly less able to handle any kind of challenges from these different kinds of disaster or hazards. And it is well known that many older adults have at least 2 to 3 chronic conditions, and they may have more than 5 or so prescription medications. And how are those things handled, say, during and especially at recovery? And at the beginning and at the front end is making sure that they have that supply available, which could also mean that they will need additional funding in order for them to get that extra supply that they have to keep on their kit. And slide 12 is related to cohort experiences. This is an important variable that we need to be aware of. What are the experiences of are cohorts of older adults that influence their behavior and attitude towards first responders and mandates such as evacuation. Ask, as you are working with this older elderly population, what has happened in the past that might have triggered a change in their life and in their attitudes. And I'll have a few more slides a little later so I can talk a little bit more about this concept. So the next slide, number 13, is another study. And this time the study was done and looked at websites and raised the question, to what extent are the issues for racial and ethnic communities in public health agents emergencies that addressed the information and resources for disaster preparedness and resilience. If you look down the percentages, you can easily spot where the gaps are from the results. Almost 50% of these websites did not include this population, and about 13% had information or had committed their resources to the ethnic minority communities. And, you know, Paula and I think are just very much in sync with this when Paula says he hasn't found really anything in terms of really working with geriatric disaster preparedness and resilience. So the next slide now is information related to a focus group that was held in Los Angeles with older Vietnamese Americans, and they were asked, you know, how would you seek help? And the topic about police as a resource came up, and this is some of the things that they had said. And clearly what they have here is a great reluctance to engage the police department, because in their experiences in Vietnam, they had some problems with the police. And so the fear of the police or possibly a person in uniform might be something that might create some issues, like, for example, in evacuations, mandatory evacuation. The next slide is another focus group of American Indians of the Passamaquoddy Nation, and they live in an island in Maine. They were also asked about seeking help in an evacuation, and they said absolutely no evacuation for them. We will not leave their place. We would rather talk to our clan mother. They'll help, and she'll help us make decisions, and we do not accept help from the government. And then they recall the kinds of historical things that the American Indians had experienced in the hands of the government. So the next slide is a focus group held with older women who were immigrants from Somalia. They too were asked about using shelters, and I was quite really taken by the responses, where one of the things that they were really worried about were for their younger female members of the family and the kind of violence that they experienced in shelters, evacuation shelters in Somalia. So these are some of the historical experiences that I'd mentioned earlier. And in your area, one way to also get a good feel of what the community is to try and see which different ethnic or cultural groups are predominant in your community. So when you are planning for preparedness training or exercises, you can incorporate the language that they speak and also some of their beliefs and some of their historical experiences. They can be sensitive to those. And the next slide is now, what is the significance of what I have just been talking of in my previous slides? Using part of gap analysis tool, which was the one developed by the California Primary Care Association, information from research reports and publications, and the focus groups that I just talked about, we can see trends that requires actions on our part, on us service providers and responders, to improve preparedness and resilience for older adults from ethnic minority communities. The trends include that we see there is very little or no participation from the older adult ethnic communities, that there is very limited flow of information to these communities, and there's hardly really any inclusion of populations with special needs on those with functional and access needs. And on the next slide, to continue on, resolution of negative experiences, building trust, and overcoming fear of authority, those are also some of the gaps in our services that we need to address when we are working with the ethnic elders from various communities. So the next slide, which is the 19, it lists some of the suggestions that we received from the ethnic minority elders when we held community-based interviews, and recommendations on how we can increase their preparedness and their resilience. And language interpreters was one of the majority of them have said, and especially for the American Indians, they wanted to have a place to go in their community, because then that's a familiar environment for them. And where some Asians, and in particular the Filipinos, were worried about payment for the services. And can you imagine if at a certain point they need emergency preparedness, emergency disaster services, and they are hesitant to receive it because they're worried about getting billed for it later. They did emphasize also the importance of educating, particularly the staff and volunteers in the shelters. And also, they wanted to be consulted on day one when an agency or a community is planning for a certain aspect of preparedness. They want to be at the ground level in the preparations for actions and activities. The next slide is more continuation of the action plans, and this time based on the information that I have gathered for this webinar. One, I think, critical action plan is to build trust and long-term partnership. And we could do this by seeking assistance and advice from a culture guide or a culture bridge or a culture navigator. And some of these individuals may be actually in your workplace. They may come from that specific population in their community, and they may be the individuals who could guide you in connecting with the ethnic community. And seek the advice of the culture guide and the community leaders. And like for the American Indians in Maine, if the clan mother is available, that might be a useful resource. Look out for cultural events and ethnic activities in your community, because that's another way that you can find out who are the leaders, what is important to the community, and you may be able to use some of that information later for developing or enhancing your preparedness plans. If you can, create an advisory council. Please go back to this slide. Please create an advisory council of respected members of the community and develop some communication models that you can use, not just for planning, but so you can also use actually when there's an actual disaster in progress. I just want to let you know that this is an 81-page report on a gap analysis that was held in Florida in the city of Dunedin. And if you would like to look at this document, it is a complete description of what they did and the kinds of action plans that they had. So if you just want to have an example of this, you can access this on the link. Also, on the SGEC webinar, I had a handout there that has the abstract of this report and also the table of contents. So you can look at that and see if you'd like to then look at the 81-page document. I would like to end with my talk with an ancient Chinese fable. It is about the monkey and the fish that got swept into a treacherous flood. They, of course, didn't know anything about global warming. The monkey saw a low-hanging branch at a tree and pulled himself to safety. And wishing to help this fish, he grabbed it up onto the branch. The lesson learned is good intentions are not enough. To give effective health assistance, one must understand the nature of those who are in need, who we wish to help. And this is the end of my talk, and I think we have time for a Q&A. And again, I thank you for your participation.
Okay, thank you, Melen. And now we do have some questions already. And Charlene asks, has the CCHC emergency preparedness gap analysis been used in previous studies?
So far, I had not seen on their website that it had been used as a study within a rigorous research design. I think this was developed as a quick tool that members of the association can use and take to their clinics. And so I had not seen any report yet. And I think that this is a relatively new one, because when Paula and I were at a meeting early this year, I had raised the question about what's happening with the primary care clinics, because most of the preparedness activities were focusing on hospitals, the acute care. And the response I received at that time was saying, well, we are just beginning to address the clinics and the community health centers, because if there is ever a surge in a disaster, the original plan has been to go to the hospital, but now we cannot just all go to the hospital. And the next plan was they would go to the long-term care facilities, the nursing homes. Now that's going to be an issue as well. So the next thing now that is being considered, which they feel would be make sense, because many people would be from the community, and if their primary care clinics are open, then they could go there and seek the kind of health and social services that they need.
There is another question actually from Marilyn. Can you provide examples of cohort experiences, i.e., what are some of the past experiences that may influence an older adult's responses in emergency situations?
Mm-hmm. Oh, is that a question to ask for additional examples?
I guess their psychological background, what they've been keyed by past experience to do.
Right. And I think if we, going back to the focus group, for example, with the Vietnamese group in Los Angeles, when they talked about the police department and how they said they wanted to stay away from the police department because when they were in Vietnam, they associated the police as trouble. You know, the police will appear at your doorsteps because there is a problem. They think that there is a problem. And so you can get swept into a problem situation. And they bring that to the U.S. when some of them, many of them were evacuated and they came to the U.S. and resettled here. And now we have certain communities where we have Vietnamese immigrants and also already Vietnamese Americans. So these stories are still living with them. And so when thinking about getting help, they would not pick up, they wouldn't pick up a phone, the phone to call the police. Or if they see a car coming in their, a police car coming in their neighborhood, that probably some of them might start getting really very fearful and agitated because of the experiences that they have had in Vietnam. That's similar with the Somali women who, if Somali has been wrecked with so much wars and killings and all that, and refugees who go into refugee shelters have certain experiences. And the Somali women here, it said, going to a shelter where there are men is just something that they would not consider because they had seen, or perhaps some of them had experienced, having been raped, brutalized in the refugee camps. So these are some of the, what I'm mentioning, that helping them to overcome these negative experiences so that then they can create a much more positive perception of the resources that are available for to them in order to be better prepared for disaster. One great example, though, is, again, another a Vietnamese community in New Orleans. You might have heard of this community there where they moved to New Orleans after they were evacuated from Vietnam, and they settled there, and they were very successful in getting their community going, their businesses and stuff. Then here comes Katrina. And their community was almost just decimated, their livelihood, their homes, and they had fallen into Great Depression. However, because of the community, and there were other Vietnamese communities, especially coming from the California, there were groups that went to New Orleans and helped that community to get back on their feet. And this is one real success story because they really had still, despite the angst that they experienced from having again lost a lot because of the hurricane, they had the largest number of community residents who returned back to their community, and now it's beginning to really pick up and flourishing. The Tulane University has a project, actually, and I can't remember the department, but it probably is either an anthropology or a sociology department, where they are inviting people who have experienced the devastation of Katrina and are back in the community to go and share their story in a short video so they can go to the department where these videos are being done. And I do not have the link to those, but they put it, and they're willing to put it up on the website so that then, and it's open to the public, you can, if you find it there, you can listen to the different stories of people who have experienced Katrina and how they managed to pull themselves back up. And, you know, their story of resilience. And so some inspiring stories. I hope that answered the question about the kinds of experiences that might impede a healthy process of developing more capacity to respond to disaster.
Okay, thank you, Melen, and thank you, Paula. Thank you again for your participation in today's webinar, and we hope to see you again.